don't tap into the ancestral presence in the waters. These prophetic words were spoken by the late Tony K. Bambara in 1989 during the Black Storytellers Conference at Mega Evers College. Bambara's sentiments ignited a flame for the first annual tribute to the ancestors at Coney Island Beach in New York. That was some 20 years ago. It was spearheaded by Dr. Umalo of Mega Evers and Brother Tony Akim of the People of the Sun Collective in New York. The descendant community began to reclaim those poems and to tap into the ancestral presence in the waters. The event has grown over the years to hundreds of people gathering at the water to drum, dance, sing, pray, educate, recite poetry, and pay homage to those African ancestors who perished during the transatlantic voyage. So that's how it began in Brooklyn, New York, some 20 years ago. So the history as it relates to here in Charleston, the Charleston Remembrance Program was formed in 1998 by my father, Osei Chandler, Sister Deborah Wright, and Quadro Campbell. So there were two forces at work that attended to this initiative. Deborah had just recently moved to Charleston from Brooklyn, New York, and had approached my father about starting the program here in Charleston. My father had already been in touch with Brother Adeyemi Bandele, who was also a part of the organizing in Brooklyn as well. And so the decision was made to go ahead and move forward. My father contacted Quadro, and they discussed the best place to hold this program. And it was decided that Sullivan's Island would be an appropriate place because of the port of entry for the ships bringing their cargo of captive Africans into the region. They went to Fort Moultrie and met with the superintendent, John Tucker, at the time to determine that the National Park Service would be amenable to our use of this historic site and facility. And they've been very helpful over the years. They've been with us all along. I don't know, is Colin still out there?
I'm back here.
There she is. Okay. Colin's standing in the dark. She's behind the scenes a little bit. I got to tell you that she has been very supportive from beginning to the end. And we really appreciate all the So the first program took place right here in 1998, and this is the 15th annual. Now Bob's fault, this is Coach Bob. All right, Coach Bob is our drummer, and he is always down. He's been the right-hand man for so many people in Charleston, on so many levels, and we're glad to have him. So Bob's fault and his sons, Dorothy Flood,
Thank you.
Park Service, one of the goals of the Park Service is to stay involved with the community, and to do community projects such as the Remembrance Ceremony. And without the involvement of the community, the Park Service, it would not be here today. And so it's our job to reach out to the community, get involved, listen to the people, see what they want to be involved with, and participate in fully. And that's why the Park Service, especially Carl and Tim and Mike Allen, that's why they're so involved with the Remembrance Ceremony and so involved with getting the message out. And something I was telling Zeke about before I got started that I want everyone here to know about, especially if you're a teacher or you know someone in school that goes to a Title I school that may not have the money to go out for something or come out for a motion. We're constantly applying for grants at the Park Service, and recently we applied for a Ticket to Ride grant, which would provide transportation to students from Title I schools, elementary through 12, to come out for something. It'll be a trip that's by no cost to the school. And so if we don't know about that, and if the teachers don't know about it, their children won't get that opportunity. So please spread the word to teachers, community members, to stay involved with the Park Service. Contact Carl, contact myself, contact Mike Allen to find out what opportunities there are for children here at the Park Service. And that goes from field trips to even job opportunities. Like when I started, I was still a student at SC State and got involved in a summer program called the STEP program that was my foot in the door to working with the park. And since 2007, I've grown as a person. My knowledge, the history of Sullivan's Island and Charleston, period. And I want to share something I learned involving one of the places we played soccer at. When I started playing soccer, Coach will say we had what's called a Romney Field. It's the area where you were like me, you had a free public education here in South Carolina. You could look to men like Robert Smalls, who played an integral part in free public education in this state. And that policy was eventually adopted throughout the country. And also, if you were in the Marines and you were stationed at Parris Island at one time, you can look to Robert Smalls for that as well. And so we have brochures on the desk, and so I definitely recommend that you grab one of the Robert Smalls brochures. And we also have information about 54th Massachusetts, which is a regiment that we'll be commemorating next month in July. And we also have the African Pastors brochures. So there's a lot of information here that we have for the public, and we have enough on hand. So if there's anything that you want to learn about further after today, just find myself, find Carl, and any of the other Marines, and we'll be glad to share that information with you. All right? So thank you for your time, and ready to move on. All right?
He is a former features writer at the Post-Imperial, where he covered healthcare, the criminal and civil courts, and the police beat. He has edited and reported for the state newspaper in Columbia, South Carolina.
West Africa and Sierra Leone in particular. But West Africa did not provide the bulk of the people who came to the New World, particularly the people who came to the United States. West Central Africa,
this area here,
which are the countries of the Congo, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and Angola, accounts for about 40% of all the people who came to the Western Hemisphere. Now, the question is how many people came? Probably one of the most reliable sources of counting people who came is the Transatlantic Slave Trade Database, which you can find at that web address, and I invite you to, I encourage you to visit it because it is very, very informative. They have